Let me say, first of all, a word about the title of the talk, in particular the term Marxian concept. Titles have to be short. So Marxian concept there just means of Marx. I'm trying to say that concept of a transitional society is not coherent within the context of Marx's thought. I'm not trying to say somebody holds to the notion of a transitional society, they're not a Marxist. The question of who is or is not a Marxist doesn't interest me. I want to thank Workers and Punks University for inviting me here and for all of your work to make the May Day School possible. I also want to thank you for publishing Two Peas in a Pod, a critique of positions on the Eurozone crisis put forward by Kostas Lapavitsis and Michel Song that Andrew Clark and I wrote. And we're pleased that people in Greece that we sent the English version to liked it so much that they immediately translated and published it in Greek. I know that there should be some representatives of Syriza, maybe some other Greek comrades here. I mean, it's Greek to me, but if anybody can read this, I would like to put copies in their hands. And perhaps that might contribute a bit to the fight back in Greece against the efforts to solve the crisis on the backs of working people. Andrew Clark and I are also very pleased that you published this article of ours, despite the fact that its political implications are controversial among you. And you even suggested that in my talk here this evening, I focus on what might be a related issue, the notion of a so-called transitional society between capitalism and socialism. Such solidarity and respect for conflicting ideas is in our experience extremely rare. We're accustomed to having our views suppressed, and the lies and personal vilification, so we're really deeply grateful. So since the theme of this May Day School is accumulation, I want to begin by discussing the concept of primitive socialist accumulation put forward by the Bolshevik economic thinker Evgeny Preobrazhensky in his 1926 book, The New Economics. At the time, he was part of the left opposition to Stalin, and in his view, the economy of the Soviet Union at that moment was partly a commodity-producing economy and partly a socialist economy. He regarded part of it as socialist because it was state-owned and controlled, and because it used planning rather than spontaneous market forces to determine prices, levels of output, and the allocation of resources and workers. He regarded the relationship between the two parts of the economy as an antagonistic one. He spoke of a, quote, struggle of the socialist planning principle against the spontaneity of commodity production, close quote. So in this view, what would a fully socialist economy be? Well, it would be a totally planned economy with total state ownership and control of the means of production. And so what was needed to achieve this was a process of transition in which the state-owned, planned part of the economy became an ever larger part, crowding out the market-regulated private part of the economy until the latter part disappeared. And the policy of primitive socialist accumulation that Preobrazhensky proposed was an effort to speed up this transition. Rapid accumulation of state capital, investment in production, in other words, would enlarge the state sector of the economy. It would also weaken the private sector, because Preobrazhensky's plan called for the, quote, alienation of part of the surplus product of the private economy for the benefit of the socialist accumulation fund, close quote. In other words, the expansion of the state sector would take place at the direct expense of the private sector, which would be forced to fund some of that expansion. And originally, Preobrazhensky called this a process of exploitation. Now, something like this was put into effect by Stalin 2 years later. Preobrazhensky and left oppositionists generally regarded Stalin's new policy as a triumph of their ideas. And so it wasn't really distinctive theoretically, his book wasn't really distinctive theoretically in that sense. And in terms of the more basic theoretical concepts, it was even less distinctive than his policy proposals. What I find most troubling and problematic about his ideas are not specific to him, but aspects that he does not even argue for, that he takes for granted because they were commonly accepted aspects of the Marxian, economic thinking of his time. In particular, his proposals for the transition from capitalism to socialism are based on the idea that more state planning, ownership, and control is progress towards socialism. And that, in turn, rests on the fundamental equation of socialism with state planning, ownership, and control. These notions were very common, and despite everything that we've had to learn by means of very hard experience, these notions still do remain common. Everybody's entitled to define socialism however he or she wishes, including Karl Marx. And the notion that socialism equals state planning, ownership, and control was alien to Marx's conception of socialism. More precisely, it was alien to his conception of what he called communist society, both in its initial phase and its higher phase. Let me first address the issue of state ownership and control, and then planning. Of course, Marx called for the abolition of private property. But what makes property private, in his view, is not individual ownership, but the separation of the direct producers, the workers, from the property that they produce. In the German ideology, he and Friedrich Engels noted that ancient communal and state ownership is still accompanied by slavery. And so the slaves were what they called communal private property. Communal private property. So there's other instances where Marx does not define socialism in terms of state property at all. In volume 2 of Capital, he wrote, "The social capital is equal to the sum of the individual capitals, including state capital, insofar as governments employ productive wage labor in mines, railways, etc., and function as industrial capitalists." And elsewhere he wrote similarly, "Where the state itself is a capitalist producer, as in the exploitation of mines, forests, etc., its product is a commodity, and hence possesses the specific character of every other commodity." And what I think is most important, in volume 1 of Capital, Marx implicitly addressed the issue of what would happen if the state's role as capitalist producer expanded to such a point that the state completely crowded out other capitalists. He argued that the tendency toward monopoly, the centralization of capital, would reach its extreme limit in a given society, only when the entire social capital was united in the hands of either a single capitalist or a single capitalist company. As Raya Dunayevskaya noted, Marx's text implies that such a society with a single capitalist would remain a capitalist society. This extreme development of complete centralization would in no way change the law of motion of that society. So in his book, Enduring, when Engels was talking about the role of the state, I think he was referring not only to his own view, but to Marx's view, and he said that state ownership does not do away with the capitalistic nature of the productive forces. The more of them the state takes over, the more does it actually become the national capitalist, the more citizens it exploits. The workers remain wage workers, proletarians. The capitalist relation is not done away with. Okay, so now what I want to do is, having dealt with property, I want to deal with the issue of planning. Preobrazhensky regarded planning and the law of value as opposites. And this too was a rather common perspective, and remained so, among Marxian economic thinkers. As Preobrazhensky used the term law of value, it was basically the same thing as the so-called law of supply and demand. It operated to the extent that prices, levels of output, allocation of resources, allocation of workers were determined by competition in markets, and only to that extent. But the equation of planning with socialism and market determination with capitalism really didn't work. Preobrazhensky and other thinkers who shared the same theoretical framework were aware that capitalism itself was becoming more planned, and thus less regulated by what they call the law of value. So with regard to the German economy during World War I, Preobrazhensky said, quote, "Production which formerly remained commodity production was transformed de facto into planned production in the most important branches. The working of the law of value in many respects was almost completely replaced. So in this view, the transition from capitalism to socialism involved the further extension of a tendency that was already operating under capitalism, the tendency to replace the law of value with planning. So actually, it's not correct, strictly speaking, in this view, to distinguish between capitalism and socialism in terms of the law of value versus planning. The distinction between these two systems really reduces to the other distinction between state and private ownership and control. In any case, Preobrazhensky's very limited conception of the law of value is quite different from Marx's. In volume 3 of Capital, Marx argued that the law of value is not affected by the fact that commodities' prices differ from their actual values. So it's not a pricing issue. Okay, the difference between prices and actual values, he says, does not abolish surplus value itself, nor the total value of commodities as the source of these various price components. So the law of value, whether it operates or not, that's not a question of how the prices of individual commodities are determined. On this view that Marx is putting forth here, what matters is whether the products are commodities, things that are not only useful, but also possess value, and whether the total value of all the commodities taken together is determined by the amount of labor needed to produce them. If that's the case, then the law of value, as Marx is using the term, is operative. Now, Marx recognized that socialist production must be planned. But planning by itself was not the central issue for him. He wrote in volume 1 of Capital that the veil is not removed from the process of life, the veil is not removed from the process of material production until it becomes production by freely associated people and stands under their conscious and planned control. So first, there's a crucial issue here of whether the producers are freely associated. And that's an issue that was almost completely absent from Preobrazhensky's book. But even if we restrict our focus just to planning, note that Marx indicates here that production must stand under the conscious and planned control of the direct producers. The issue here is whether the contents of the plan are determined by the producers themselves, or whether the contents of the plan are determined by economic laws and imperatives over which the producers have no control. When the law of value in Marx's sense is operative, the labor time necessary to produce the products asserts itself as a regulative law of nature in the same way that the law of gravity asserts itself when a person's house collapses on top of them. In 1943, Raya Dunayevskaya challenged the idea that concentration of all capital in the hands of the state would make it possible to raise workers' standard of living. The problem, once again, is that she argued, the determination of products' values by the labor time socially necessary to produce them, okay, that law of value will assert itself regardless of what the planners want and regardless of what they put into the plan. If the state tries to raise workers' standard of living, then the cost of production of a commodity rises above the cost in the surrounding world market. Then production ceases because the commodity cannot compete with a cheaper commodity from a value-producing economy. Or the society will ultimately be defeated by the more efficient capitalist nations in the present form of capitalist competition in 1943, which is total imperialist war. So to compete effectively in the world market, governed by the law of value, the plan must be governed by the necessity to pay the laborer the minimum and to extract from him the maximum surplus value. And as long as that is the case, Dunayevskaya said, that is how long capitalist relations of production exist, no matter what you name the social order. Now, the economic policies that Preobrazhensky proposed 87 years ago for a country that no longer exists, they're not of any particular interest to us now. but his ideas regarding the transition from capitalism to socialism do remain of interest, I think, for another reason. They are an example, just one example, of the view that political changes and/or legal changes are the determining factors in social change. This continues to be a very widely held view among Marxists, anarchists, autonomists, and so forth. Paresh Chattopadhyay, who's an important Marx scholar, has argued, and I think correctly, that Preobrazhensky's concept of transition makes legal changes, changes in the law, the determining factor. It does so because it equates capitalism with a specific form of ownership and socialism with a different form of ownership. But forms of ownership are legal relations. In Preobrazhensky's book, the transition from socialism, from capitalism to socialism is thus conceived as a transition from one legal form of ownership to another one. The change in legal form produces a change in the character of the society and change in the character of its production relations, and it does so automatically almost, or really as a matter of definition. Here's how Chattopadhyay puts it. Preobrazhensky conceives the transitional economy purely in terms of changes in property relations or forms. Capitalism is supposed to change automatically into socialism along with it. Ownership relations, forms, are taken as an independent variable in the process of social transformation. Preobrazhensky thereby seems to be suffering from what Marx had long ago denounced as metaphysical or juridical legal illusion in his critique of Proudhon. And it's very interesting that Preobrazhensky, in his book, The New Economics, actually addressed this issue at one point. He posed the question, perhaps the replacement of private ownership by social ownership on all commanding heights is merely a formal juridical legal act which involves no change in the essence of the system? But he asked this only rhetorically. He didn't answer it. He evidently regarded the question as too absurd to be taken seriously. I don't think it is. Nowadays, the idea that state ownership and control of the means of production is sufficient to change the essence of the system, that it constitutes socialism, it's a lot less popular than it used to be. But somewhat similar ideas do remain popular. For instance, in the midst of the global financial crisis, some leftist economists called for state control or nationalization of the banking system. For instance, Rick Wolf called for state control together with the banks to be managed by workers. And he said that if workers served on their own board of directors in the banks, workers' well-being would displace individual enterprise profits as the prevailing objective. Okay, so they would no longer be oriented to maximization of profit, but to workers' well-being. Fred Mosley and John Weeks called for nationalization of finance. Mosley argued that if the state is in charge of the banks can be transformed from institutions interested in maximum profit into institutions that pursue public policy objectives. And therefore, he said that the nationalization of banks could be an important step on the road to socialism. But there can't be socialism in one country. Nationalization in one country. What results when you try to have socialism in one country is state capitalism, a state-run system that's still embedded in the capitalist global economy and still locked into a competitive battle with capitals elsewhere in the world. A state-run bank, it's still a bank. It still has to obtain funds before it can lend those funds out, and to obtain the funds, it must provide a decent return to those who supply it with funds. And that's true of a worker-run bank as well. But to get hold of those funds and supply a decent return, its investment decisions cannot be based on what will enhance workers' well-being or on public policy objectives. If the enhancement of workers' well-being or public policy objectives would reduce the bank's profitability significantly in relationship to the profitability of banks with which it competes, it's hard to imagine that that would not be the case. A bank that would dare to pursue those goals would find that lenders and investors will simply not supply it with the funds it needs in order to compete successfully or even survive. in order to survive, a state-run or worker-run bank has to pursue the goal of profit maximization just like any other bank. The belief that political changes and or legal changes are the determining factors in social change, that takes a number of other forms that are very popular today. It seems that most people want to see another world, but think it can come about, if at all, you know, some think it can't, but if it can come about, people think, well, we can vote in a different world, or it'll be different if workers become their own bosses, or if we pay everybody the same amount, or through whatever political, legal, administrative measures they've been led to believe will accomplish the redistribution of wealth and power that will make their lives better. And specifically on the anti-capitalist left, the typical view of how to transcend capitalism goes something like this. First, to change people's consciousness, or their consciousness changes through their participation in new forms of organization, which is political. The change in consciousness allows us to increase our side's political power to the point where we take control, either through elections or by seizing power. And once our side has political power, we can then change the nature of the economy and the state simply by deciding to put people before profit and implementing what we decide. Okay, so we're going to need the right political forms of organization to accomplish this, and there's a whole lot of debate about what are the right forms of organization. But if we do have the right forms of organization, then according to this thinking, overcoming capitalism is then a very simple matter. We decide, through these forms of organization, what should be produced, what shouldn't be produced. We decide how to redistribute resources and goods fairly. We decide on other social priorities, and then we just put these decisions into effect. I think this picture of social change is in the minds of almost the whole of the anti-capitalist left, from proponents of the Vanguard Party all the way to anarchists. The obvious problem that is overlooked here is the problem of unintended consequences. The consequences you get if you don't intend them. If you make a decision and implement it, you can't assume that the result, the consequences, will be what you expected or intended. As the saying goes, the road to hell is paved with good intentions. After all, no one, including Stalin, intended to turn the USSR into the monstrosity it became. Now, if the unintended consequences are just mistakes, it might be possible to correct them over time simply through experimentation, doing things a bit differently, and seeing if that improves matters. But experimentation is not a solution if the unintended consequences are the result of the fact that the economic laws of capitalism continue to govern your supposed new society. If the labor time necessary to produce the products continues to assert itself as a regulative law of nature, if you have to pay workers the minimum and extract from them the maximum, despite your intentions, in order to compete effectively, there is going to be a continual stream of unintended consequences that you will not be able to eliminate through experimentation. A country that tries to improve the standard of living of its workers too much will not be competitive. State-run banks that try to pursue public policy objectives instead of profit, or to enhance the workers' well-being instead of profit, they will lack the funds to do so, and so on. So the problem here is not that you've made mistakes. And so experimentation, you know, correcting mistakes won't solve the problem. The problem is rather this: despite your good intentions, and despite your new priorities, new forms of organization, new forms of ownership, new laws, and the new name you give your society, it remains capitalist. And it remains capitalist because the economic laws that govern capitalism continue to govern your society. And they continue to govern your society because the new priorities, new forms of organization, new forms of ownership, and so forth are not enough by themselves to overcome the economic laws of capitalism. And this is, above all, why I think we need Marx today. It's commonly said that Marx was a theorist of capitalism, not of socialism. But a lot of his work pertains directly or indirectly to the concept of a new society. And to some degree, Marx worked out what would actually be needed to transcend capitalism, to some extent. And I think we ignore this legacy at our peril. Specifically, Marx battled the thought of proudhon and proudhonism and similar tendencies on the left throughout his adult life. And why did he do that? He did not disagree with their ultimate goals. He shared those goals. But he fought a never-ending battle against these tendencies, because he thought that their alternatives to existing society just wouldn't work. They would merely be capitalism in a different form, or they would not be viable and would lead back to capitalism. And the reason why they wouldn't work, he argued, is that these supposed alternatives to capitalism all try to get rid of it without getting rid of its mode of production. I'll give you an example. Marx criticized John Gray's proposal to eliminate money. Gray wanted there to be a national bank that would issue certificates denominated in labor time. Common idea. Workers would give the products they produced to the bank, and in return the bank would give them certificates, which they could use to obtain other products held by the bank. So if you handed over products that took you a week to produce, you would get certificates that allowed you to withdraw commodities that other workers took a week to produce. Against this, Marx argued that to really eliminate money, you have to eliminate exchange value. But that requires that you eliminate commodities. And to eliminate commodities, you have to eliminate commodity production, and that requires that labor be directly social, in contrast to existing society, where private labor becomes social indirectly through the exchange of its products. It's a lot of jargon, but I'll get to the bottom line soon. Okay, so Marx says if labor were directly social, okay, true, exchange value would not be turned into price. We wouldn't have price, we wouldn't have money, but neither would use value be turned into exchange value, and the product wouldn't be turned into a commodity, and so the very basis of bourgeois production would be abolished. The problem, according to Marx, is that the abolition of the bourgeois mode of production isn't what Gray had in mind. He had in mind a system in which goods are produced as commodities, but not exchanged as commodities. In other words, Gray's proposal wouldn't work because it tries to change the capitalist system by eliminating its effects, but not the causes of the effects. Okay, now when Marx summarized this and similar criticisms that he made kind of continually, when he gave a general gloss on the criticisms, he typically did so by stating that changes in the relations of production are the determining factors. Changes in political and legal forms, changes in consciousness, are the consequences of the changes in the relations of production. For instance, in the preface to the work in which he criticized Gray, Marx wrote, "The totality of these relations of production constitutes the economic structure of society, the real foundation, all which arises a legal and political superstructure, and to which correspond definite forms of social consciousness. The changes in the economic foundation lead, sooner or later, to the transformation of the whole immense superstructure." And he reaffirmed this idea in the first chapter of The Capital. Such statements are often ridiculed. They're often construed as economic determinism, or they're said to deny the importance of subjectivity and human agency. I don't think that's the case. After all, if we're talking about the relations of production changing, it's people who have to change the relations of production. And that's a political activity, and it's got to be a conscious activity. So I think Marx's point is rather the following. First of all, changes in political and legal forms and changes in consciousness are not themselves changes in the relations of production. Second, if you only change the political and legal forms and consciousness, not the relations of production, the changes will not succeed in changing the character of the society. And I think Marx's most important thoughts about this issue are those in his critique of the Gotha program. This critique is important for several reasons. First of all, it contains a mature statement of Marx's view 8 years after Capital was published, and it's one of the more developed expressions of his view. It's also important because it's explicitly about the respective roles played by the mode of production, on the one hand, and political legal relations, on the other, in transforming capitalist society into socialist or communist society. And the critique of the Gulf program is important because it's a political document. Marx was opposing the political program of the new United German Social Democratic Party. And thereby he was opposing that unification of the two parties. And the primary basis of his opposition was the Gotha program's call to eliminate a key effect of capitalism, unfair income distribution, without getting rid of its causes. The core of Marx's whole argument in the critique is that society's notions of justice, its legal relations, and income distribution depend on and correspond to its mode of production. With regard to rights or law, he says, right can never be higher than the economic structure of society and its cultural development conditioned thereby. With regard to legal relations, he asks, are economic relations regulated by legal conceptions, or do not, on the contrary, legal relations arise out of economic ones? He criticizes the program for not treating existing society as the basis of the state, and the future society as the basis of the future state, but instead treating the state as if it were an independent entity. And when the local program calls for fair distribution of income, Marx responds that the treatment of distribution as independent of the mode of production, and therefore the presentation of socialism as turning principally on distribution, that's what we're about, different distribution, he says that's vulgar socialism taken over from the bourgeois economists. And he says also, the capitalist mode of production rests on the fact that the material conditions of production, the means of production, are in the hands of non-workers in the form of property, capital, and land, while the masses are only owners of labor power. If the elements of production are so distributed, then the present-day distribution of the means of consumption or income, it results automatically. If the material conditions of production, however, are the cooperative property of the workers themselves, then there likewise results a distribution of the means of consumption or income that's different from the present one. Now keep in mind, again, that for Marx, cooperative property is not a matter of legal title. He says here that legal relations arise out of economic ones, and as I noted earlier, he understood that there could be such a thing as communal private property. Now, as I understand the critique of the Gotha program, Marx argues that in order for the means of production to be the cooperative property of the workers themselves, exchange of products has to be eliminated. That requires the elimination of value and the production of value, and that in turn requires that labor become directly social, in the sense that an hour of one worker's labor is equal to an hour of every other worker's labor. And this equality of labors, again, is not the result of a legal decree. You can't just pass a law, labor is equal. Okay, for that to be real, there has to be economic changes in the economic foundation of society to make that real. I don't have time to explicate or defend that reading of the critique of the Gotha program right now. If you wish, we can talk about this in the discussion. What I want to turn to now is another statement in the critique of the Gotha program, something that Marx doesn't say, actually. Okay. What he does say is this: between capitalist and communist society lies the period of the revolutionary transformation of the one into the other. There corresponds to this also a political transition period in which the state could be nothing but the revolutionary dictatorship of the proletariat. Now, what's this political transition? It's the transition from the capitalist state, which enforces the rule of the minority over the majority, to a workers' state, which enforces the rule of the majority over the minority, to the situation in which there is no state. Once capitalist society has been transformed into socialist society, the initial phase of communism, there are no social classes, and so there's no need for a state to enforce class rule. The state dies out, or as it said, withers away. So Marx does refer to a transition, but not to a transitional society. There's the revolutionary transformation of capitalist society into communist society, and a corresponding political transition period. The myth that Marx was a proponent of a transitional society is based on confusing transformation with transition. This may have started with Lenin. He wrote a book that I have a tremendous amount of respect for, The State and Revolution. But I think he got the following wrong. He quoted what I just quoted from Marx at the top there, and then Lenin wrote, "Now the question is put somewhat differently by Marx. The transition from capitalist society to communist society is impossible without a political transition, period." So he substitutes for the word transformation, transition. But transformation and transition are different concepts. A transformation is a radical change. One thing becomes another thing. That's all. How that change occurs is not part of the concept of transformation itself. And the transformation doesn't necessarily take place by means of a transition. If I flip the light switch, I transform a light room into a dark room with no transition. In any case, I don't think the idea of a transitional society, an intermediate society in between capitalism and socialism, makes any sense within the context of Marx's thought. It does make sense given some other conceptions of capitalism and socialism, but not Marx's. For instance, the idea of a transitional society makes perfect sense if one thinks, as Preobrazhensky did, that capitalism is private ownership while socialism is state ownership. In that case, there is indeed a third kind of society in between the two, in which there's both private and state ownership. And the move from capitalism to socialism is thus a transition from less to more to complete state ownership. And there are other conceptions of social change in which the idea of a transitional society also makes perfect sense. For instance, one idea that's been popular recently is that the new society will be the completed process of occupying space and establishing new forms of organization on occupied space. On this conception, there's again a third kind of society in between capitalism and the new society. Society with elements of both of them. And the move from capitalism to the new society is again a process of transition. The quantitative increase in occupied space and new forms of organization. Transition. But I don't think the idea of a transitional society in between capitalism and socialism is coherent as a Marxian concept, a concept within the framework of Marx's ideas. A transitional state in between the capitalist state and the socialist non-state, that makes perfect sense as a Marxian concept, but a transitional society doesn't. The difference has to do with the difference I've been emphasizing in this talk, between political and legal forms on the one hand, and the mode of production, the economic foundation of society, on the other hand. In Marx's view, changes in the economic foundation produce changes in the political, legal, and legal forms, not the opposite. Political domination is rooted in class antagonisms. Class antagonisms, in turn, are rooted in the existence of the division of society into classes. And the division of society into classes is rooted in the mode of production. So the transition from the capitalist state to the socialist non-state makes sense as a Marxian concept because this transition is based on and corresponds to the revolutionary transformation of the mode of production. Once the mode of production is transformed, society won't be divided into classes. So there won't be any class antagonisms. And that eliminates the need for a state in the proper sense of the term. There's a transition from the rule of the minority to the rule by the majority to the rule of all. Okay. So the transformation of the capitalist mode of production into the socialist mode of production, that produces the transition from the capitalist state to the socialist non-state. But if we try to create an analogy here, and we ask, what transformation of the capitalist mode of production into the socialist mode of production could produce a transition from the capitalist mode of production into the socialist mode of production, it just doesn't make any sense. It's almost a tautology. So there's no genuine analogy between the political transition and the revolutionary transformation of the mode of production. In the view of Marx and Engels, capitalist relations of production are the basis for the existence of the state. So if the basis changes, this causes the legal and political superstructure to change. But can we say that if the basis changes, this causes the basis to change? The basis changes, this causes the basis to change? No, that's just incoherent drivel. So capitalism is based on the capitalist mode of production, in Marx's view. Socialism is based on the socialist mode of production. If there's a third kind of society in between them, what is its mode of production? Capitalism is governed by the law of value, in Marx's sense, and related economic imperatives that are specific to it. Socialism isn't. What about the third distinct kind of society that supposedly lies in between? Is it governed by these specifically capitalist laws and imperatives, or isn't it? If the answer is that the transitional society is partly governed by them, let me ask, is a woman carrying a small fetus only partly pregnant? The logic of capital is totalizing. The failures of state capitalism and the welfare state, social democracy, those failures have shown that these things cannot control the logic of capital. It batters down all Chinese walls. It creates a world in its own image. So I can certainly imagine an unstable state of flux in the process of transforming capitalism into socialism. You know, an unstable state in which capitalism's economic laws and imperatives haven't yet been fully dismantled. Okay, but I just simply cannot imagine a third kind of society as distinct from an unstable state of flux in which capitalism's economic laws and imperatives both do and do not operate. So I'm not arguing that everything has to change all at once. I'm not denying that some changes must be gradual. My point is rather that transitional society is incoherent as a Marxian concept. It does not help, it hurts, efforts to understand and return to the perspective of the revolutionary transformation of society that Marx projected. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Andrew, for this great talk. Now for the questions and comments and the whole debate. My two colleagues, yes, just raise your hand and they will bring the microphone to you.
I suppose that the point you were making was specific for the change from capitalism to communism. I mean, to be more exact, is the change from feudalism to capitalism a change which we can call a transition period or a period of revolutionary transformation?
Should I do this one at a time?
I think we should take one at a time, yes, yes.
actually, I think it's a poor choice of words. I think it began with Marx even to refer to a transition from feudalism to capitalism. It actually didn't happen. As Marx writes in the Part 8, so-called primitive accumulation, there was an intermediate period of about a century, which is what he called the golden age of the English independent peasant yeomen. In which they were free. The serfdom no longer even existed. It really didn't exist. So there was a period of a free peasantry that was not serfs. And so the enclosures and the whole process of primitive accumulation were not things that dismantled feudalism. They dismantled the individual property of the peasant. So I can't answer it any other way than just historically what I think took place.
Andrew, I have two points. One,
two comments, and the second leads into a question. With respect to the first comment, I would say that Preobrazhensky is far worse than you described. It's not only a problem of his identification of state ownership with socialism, state ownership which of course was managed by one-man management, rather than by any concept of workers' control, but Preobrazhensky also didn't understand the peasantry at all. There are significant theoretical, interesting ideas of Preobrazhensky, but not when it comes to primitive socialist accumulation, where he in fact completely distorts Marx's concept of primitive capitalist accumulation. One person who understood the failings and problems of Preobrazhensky and understood the peasantry better was Lenin, who in 1922, commenting on Preobrazhensky's theses for the party to do work in the countryside, described those as filled with pious wishes unsupported by facts and characteristic of the intelligentsia study circle and the literature. And I go into this in my talk because I am doing a critique, among other things, of Preobrazhensky's primitive socialist accumulation. So that was one comment on that. We're basically in agreement on all that. The other thing is you mentioned Parash Chattopadhyay, and I have enormous respect for Parash's work. We've been long friends and mutual critics. But I think that Parash is a wonderful scholar. But Parash has a tendency, which is familiar of many people on the left, Marxists, which is when you hate capitalism very strongly, the worst thing you can say about a society that has nationalized the means of production is to call it capitalist. That you are in fact, just simply, this is like a swear word, in that particular case. And I suggest that is characteristic of an idealist position, because it's treating a category independent of the context in which it developed and applying it to another society. In contrast to that idealistic perspective, a concrete materialist conception of history examines a society concretely. It examines its characteristics carefully and then develops a theory in which to explain that concrete totality that has been its starting point. That's what I attempted to do in my book, The Contradictions of Real Socialism, The Conductor and the Conducted, to examine that society, the Soviet society and others, and concluded that rather than talking about a state capitalism, which to me is a fallacy because there's no valorization process, no MCM prime focus on the part of those who are making decisions, but rather I called it a society characterized by vanguard relations of production. And that was the conclusion that I came from a concrete study of the nature of the Soviet economy. So what I want to ask you is, what is the concrete basis for your designation of the Soviet Union and those societies as state capitalists?
Yeah, on the first point, I basically agree with you, and it isn't only Preobrazhensky that underestimated the peasantry. I mean, that's characteristic of Trotsky's thought as well, and it pervades a lot of Trotskyism, even post-Trotsky. And I also agree that there have been a lot of people who used the term state capitalism as a swear word. My thinking is rooted in the work of Raya Dunayevskaya, and she said that a lot of people just use state capitalism as a swear word. Her work is different. It's based on a return to Marx's Capital at a crucial moment, the time of the Hitler-Stalin Pact, and working out the implications of what Marx says in that historical context. She was secretary to Trotsky in Coyoacan, Mexico, and she breaks with Trotsky, and she returns to Marx's Capital, and so there is a whole new interpretation of capital underlying this. And the crucial question then is, it's not so much about the USSR, it's what is capitalism? And that's what I tried mostly to clarify in my talk. You know, capitalism is not markets. Capitalism is not, you know, private property in the sense that most of us think. You know, it is private property in the sense of it's not the property of the direct producers, but it wasn't the property of the direct producers in the USSR either, you know, despite what the law said. You know, it's not about money. Those are forms of capitalism. Now, you have a society, you don't like it. Okay? But what makes it capitalism? The question then is, what is it about such societies in the USSR that makes them like capitalism in its private property form and unlike every other society? Okay? So that we can actually say this is a distinct kind of society. For instance, if you say, well, it was exploitative, that's not enough to say that it's capitalism, because there's other forms of exploitation that are not capitalist. But in terms of the concepts that Dunayevskaya worked out, partially in concert with C.L.R. James, we have a lot of things that are totally new about the society. First of all, value pervading the entire society, abstract wealth, instead of just wealth in particular concrete forms. There was abstract wealth in that society, and that's why it could be measured in money terms, rubles. And they definitely wanted to self-expand the amount of wealth they had in terms of rubles. And that's accumulation of capital. And MCM prime is accumulation of capital. What other society besides capitalism has this drive to expand? To accumulate. You know, in previous societies where wealth was concrete, the slaves, the serfs, or whatever, were producing for the benefit of individual people. You know, the slave owner, or, you know, the land owner. So they were fulfilling the luxury needs and whatever of, you know, the ruling class. But a human being's needs are limited. You know, how many, you know, whatever can you eat? You know, how many houses can you live in? Okay, so accumulation doesn't really exist or exists only in a very limited manner in societies that are not capitalist. You need abstract wealth, not particular concrete, useful things to consume. Once you've got that abstract wealth, you've got this possibility and you get this reality of ceaseless expansion. You know, accumulation for accumulation's sake, production for production's sake. That's what we have all throughout the capitalist world. That's what they had in the USSR. In the first five-year plan, they said that the goal was to catch up with and outdistance the capitalist lands. How? By means of accumulation, of abstract wealth. Okay. And then the question is, were they in fact subject to the law of value in the broader sense that, that Marx talked about it, the determination of value by labor time? I think they definitely were. Okay. As a law of the world market. I mean, the key thing is that labor time does not count above and beyond what's needed at the level of the social average. And if you're trying to catch up with and outdistance the lands that you call capitalists, you know, well, what you're going to want are workers who work most efficiently, you know, and they're going to be the ones who are going to get paid more. You're going to have speed up of production. You're going to have stakhanovism, and so forth. You're going to be, for purposes of accumulation, you're going to be paying workers the minimum and trying to extract the maximum from them. So I think that that's definitely, it's an historically unprecedented mode of production, different from all past forms of exploitation, but it's common to, you know, the USSR and so forth, and common to private Western capitalism.
Okay, other questions, comments? Mm-hmm. Anyone else, just so we get prepared?
Yeah, I'd like to thank Andrew for a very incisive talk, and as of a kind I haven't heard for a while. It's kind of, I hear it as a sort of application of pure theory, or what some people might call theoretical purism. I must confess to having more sympathy with Preobrazhensky and the Bolsheviks of the 1920s than he does, or Michael Leibowitz does. They weren't dealing solely with the question of theory. They were actually trying to construct socialism in the most hostile circumstances, having just emerged from a massive imperialist offensive against the early Soviet Union and so on. So when I say I'm sympathetic, I try to understand in those circumstances the problems they confronted, even if I don't write a blank check for their solutions. Now, the problem with purism, I think, is that it has this kind of displacement effect. And what I mean in this context of Andrew's lecture, is that, okay, let's agree with him, let's abolish any concept of a transitional society. But all the kinds of issues which uses of the concept of transitional society have addressed, more successfully or less successfully or unsuccessfully, then become displaced onto the whole issue of the political transition period. So it's not that these problems go away, it's okay, we can reformulate them within a different framework, but they're still there. So what I'd like to ask Andrew, just by way of illustration, of course it's an enormous question, what are some of those issues then that are there in the political transition period that remain as issues in real worlds of struggle, in concrete conditions of struggle, when we've pushed aside the notion of a transitional society? We forget that, we push it away, but then what are we left holding and what can we do with that?
Yeah, I mean, I actually have a lot of sympathy for the Russian revolutionaries, you know, who dared. They tried to construct a new world. They knew that if they didn't get help, they would fail. They totally understand why. They knew that there was not going to be socialism in one country. They didn't really understand why. But they appealed, you know, to Germany, and it didn't work. And they appealed to China, and it didn't work. They knew the consequences. Lenin warned, he wrote about what the consequences were going to be. So it's not a question of blaming individuals. I did deal here with Preobrazhensky's concepts, which I find insufficient. And, you know, I'm not at all addressing here, you know, what should they have done in 1924 when he proposed this, or 1926 when the book came out. I mean, it was basically too late at that point. It had to fail. It had to transform into its opposite. And that's why we got Stalin. The failure of the revolution created Stalin, not the reverse. With regard to your other question, there's a premise that I can't say whether I agree or disagree with to the question, which is that all of the issues become displaced onto questions of the political transition period. I'm not even sure what you mean by that, so maybe you can clarify that. It seems to me that with different concepts of what the process of social transformation is and what is, you know, the basis and what is the superstructure, and what causes what. It seems to me that with different concepts, we do get, or conceivably can, that can shed different light on what to do. So if you could come up with a concrete example, I could maybe address that, but I'm not really understanding the question.
Yeah, I'll try to do that. It's a very, very big question, as I said. Could you give us some indication of what important elements of a socialist program in our current circumstances might be? What are the elements, or some elements, of a socialist program that is free from the kinds of illusions that you've, anatomized so well? But what then are elements of a socialist program that incorporate some of the points that you've emphasized, like self-organization, democratically organized, direct producers, and so on? Right, is that clearer?
Except for the term socialist program.
Okay, well.
Are you talking about concepts for the transformation of society, or, you know, what should Slovenia do about the euro crisis, its position in the euro crisis? Those are different issues.
Okay, then what I'd like to hear, unless I'm profoundly mistaken, is concepts and how they then translate into programmatic targets, forms of organization, whatever it might be. You know, how do we use the kind of concepts you've emphasized and translate them in principle, not, you know, in any very obvious examples, but how do they help us then translate into and construct some sort of program for socialism that involves, sooner or later, by one means or another, overcoming capitalism, as you've explained it so clearly? And what might some of those means be?
I have to confess here that I don't have the answer. I don't know that anybody has the answer. I think it's an achievement to have the questions instead of the wrong questions, and to be looking for answers in a place that I think is right. And I don't. I'm not trying to pump myself up. I think that there are other people who, you know, have begun to recognize the importance of overcoming the law of value in the broader sense that I talked about with Marx, of not just talking about political forms, but of working out new free relations of production. And not all of these people are Marxists. There's a couple of folks in the US that have a lot of disagreements with Michael Albert and Robin Hanel, but they have, you know, done work where they call it participatory economics. They've done some very good work on this question, and I think what they're talking about is flawed in a number of ways, but they're looking at the right place for answers. And the first thing I would say then is, before we start to talk about programs, we have to have a real thorough overcoming of illusions and a real return to the so-called economic determinism of Marx, which I don't think is economic determinism at all. We have to have a serious discussion of these issues. I don't think anybody has any of the answers, but it hasn't been that long that people have even talked about these questions. For the longest time, the left did not even deal with this because everybody thought they knew what socialism was. You know, it actually existed. There was actually existing socialism, so you didn't have to ask what it was. And then the only question became, oh, well, you know, it's what they have. But here, you know, in the United States, it would be democratic, you know. So we would have socialism from below, you know, or we would have socialism and democracy. I mean, so it would be like we have their economy, you know, but we have a political superstructure that's different from their economy. That was the thinking, and that's still the thinking of a lot of people. I don't have all the answers. I don't think anybody does, but I don't think that's a reason to despair, because we haven't been focused on this question long enough or consistently enough. There are not that many people focused on it. I think the two things are integral. First of all, the emancipation of the working class must be the act of the workers themselves. They can never let power get out of their hands. That is entirely fundamental. But there are a lot of ways to alienate the power. And elites will come to dominate as long as people are not equipped, the great mass of people are not equipped theoretically and intellectually to actually run society themselves without the need for experts and people over them. That doesn't mean that everybody has to know, you know, all of the principles of every kind of engineering or everybody knows how to, you know, fly an airplane, but people have to have the ability to know when they're being sold a bill of goods and when they're not. So the complete, full, free development of every individual cannot be just a goal. That development of every individual is an imperative political need right now so that the great mass of working people can take control of their own lives and keep control of their own lives and not alienate it to anybody. And when that happens, when there is actually equality in that sense that is created in this process of revolutionary transformation, when that happens, we can have directly social labor such that 1 hour of labor of one person is equal to an hour of another person. It's not something you can decree. You know, you can decree everybody's hour of labor is equal, and if you haven't changed the nature of social relations, you know, you're going to have black markets everywhere. You know, well, I'm a physician, so my labor is equal, but, you know, my labor is, you know, super equal. It's 10 times, 20 times, 100 times equal. The other thing I think is important is do not confuse particular forms of appearance or manifestations of capital with what capital is. You know, it can take different forms. It can be a farm, you know, run by human beings. It can be a farm run by animals.
I could ask really questions for next hour, but let's focus on some of the Mandel's critiques that I'm sure you're familiar with, so I'm wondering what our views of them, which is, can you hear me now better? It seems to me as if you equate money with capital, which I'm sure you don't, but that's how it seemed when you say that they wanted to accumulate rubles. In Yugoslavia, I haven't started planning in the Soviet Union, you know, I haven't got that far, but in Yugoslavia, plans were what I started expressed in quotas. So when you ask your cement factory, you didn't ask them, bring me this much of exchange value, surplus value. You ask for quotas. So there was a material level of accountancy, which is different than national accounting. And I'm not talking about Soviet Union not using services in accounting. Let's forget it. Let's just think about this. So accounting and planning took care of meeting needs. And there was no surplus, so there was no notion of exchange value in between. Of course, you knew you had to pay your goods, you had to import something, so you had to interact with foreign markets, and you were right, you had to interact with the law of value. But sometimes, especially early, that interaction went through central bank, and that went on an aggregate basis. So, you know, what Mandel said, there was no bankruptcy, there was no individual economic agents pursuing profits, they were pursuing quotas and plans. So, in that sense, I'm really confused, how can you create accumulation of meeting needs, which is a building a hospital, a building a school, a new factory to build new whatever, shipyard, or you know, produce iron. So if you equate money with capital, which I'm sure you don't, then your logic is clear. But how can you possibly have no individual agents acting as if they're on capitalist market, and yet you claim that the society in totality is capitalist?
In private market Western capitalism, at the level of a factory, success is also measured in terms of meeting material quotas.
No, 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 not on the board levels. I'm being on the board levels. No. Absolutely.
Not, not.
Not on the board level.
The board
level. Yeah. Which means...
Oh, I understand what you're saying now.
Departments, yes. I mean, I work...
In my department was measured on by what we delivered in terms of the plan that we had for the next project, but it was a mandatory budget. I mean, when it goes to board level and it goes to shareholder, there is nothing but the monetary budget.
Okay, so when the state has a plan, the individual enterprises function with respect to that state plan as individual departments do in a private business that's got many departments.
But then you have one capitalist. Then you have, you're saying that you have a capitalist state which has one economic entity.
Well, actually there was internal competition among enterprises in for instance, the USSR. It didn't work in the same way. The question you always have to ask here is a change in manifestation a change in the actual character of the thing? And pointing to a change in the manifestation does not tell us that there is a change in the character. That has to be argued for independently. Am I the same person with sunglasses on?
Yes, you are.
Well, you know, but it doesn't work the same way. You know, here I'm answering you without sunglasses, and now I'm answering you with sunglasses. So it's not the same. Okay, so the significant question is, what's fundamentally different then?
That you have a huge number of economic agents competing, that you have markets, that you have bankruptcy, that you have surplus value law being imposed by this, that you have a change. And that you actually have the price of labor pushed down, as you said correctly. Which is not the case if you have one company, like you say, the state equals company and the rest of the departments. You know,
in the USSR, the standard of living of the masses totally deteriorated from sometime in the 20s to the early 40s. And why was that? Well, it was because of the increase in the growth of means of production as against the growth of means of consumption. Okay? Expanded reproduction, the same law that dominates private capital. It's happened country after country, every capitalist country, state, private, whatever, that has grown has done so by privileging the growth of means of production as against means of consumption. Okay. The standard of living of the Russian masses fell severely.
Sorry, which period are you referring to?
From sometime in the 20s, I don't have the date exactly, into at least the early 40s. This was documented by Dunayevskaya in maybe the article that I was quoting here, through an examination of five-year plans.
So investment in infrastructure suffocates the articles of consumption, there is no mass consumption, so the workers are deprived of the product of the
workers. Look, a lot of the peasantry in the countryside was on strike. You know, whether it was called a strike or not, a lot of them were on strike, so that had a big part to play as well. But, you know, if you look at the plans, the plans were overfulfilled for the means of production and they were underfulfilled for means of consumption pretty much continually, pretty much across the board. So you can plan, but you're actually not planning because your planning is being subjected to the law of value. I mean, to me, that's the question. Since you recognize that the law of value operates at the level of the world market and that impinges on the individual country and on the enterprises in the individual country, it doesn't seem to me that we have much that we're disagreeing about.
No, we disagree because if you have a country, I mean, of course today things are different than they were back then, but if you have a country which has a huge amount of minerals and energy, you know, you can have large amount of both infrastructure and mass consumption met by internal need. You don't have, I mean, you didn't have mass market in a way that you're not implying 100 years ago.
Okay, I think you'll have a great discussion after the end of this discussion. I'm sorry, but we have to move on. So if there are any other questions or comments, please. Okay.
First, a small comment, then a question or a proposal. The comment is concerning the so-called economic determinism and the idea that the basis of the society determines the infrastructure. So now when you said in the end of your lecture that the only way for a change to come is to have masses of people who understand, who are capable of understanding, have the ability to understand the problem of the present society, of capitalist society, so that they are to be able to change it, and that this must come not from the outside, as we would say, but from the inside. I would say that if we take the presupposition of economic determinism, we cannot wish for that to happen in any time. Because if we live in a capitalist society, it will never give the possibility for this kind of mass to be produced. It will never let the people educate themselves in this way and become politically active in this way. I'm not saying that they cannot, but if we start from this hypothesis of determinism, it is not possible. Maybe I'm losing something, but correct me if I'm wrong. And the other thing, maybe about the central argument about the existence of the self-valorization process in the USSR, as in any capitalist country, but only with a different appearance. I would like you to, if you can, come back or with in the diagram. In the end, you showed that with the bubbles, the indirectly social labor is the cause. If this is the causation, it is the cause, and that if a society is capitalist, it will have indirectly social labor, and if USSR was a capitalist society in the end, in its essence, it is because of this indirectly social labor. So in what way was it indirect, and in what way could it not be indirect, and so on?
On the question of economic determinism, I mean, it's called economic determinism by its critics. I call them political determinists. I don't think, you know, Marx's position is economic determinist. I think it is what it is, and I think it's a warning that you've got to go to the root. You know, you've got to attack the economic foundation of society and transform that. And I think that there might be powers that be that will try to keep people from becoming educated and stuff. But of course, we grapple with all kinds of things that they try to do. And I don't have a solution to that. But I mean, you know, they're going to try to prevent you know, any kind of revolutionary upsurge. And whether it can happen or not doesn't depend on just what they want. One thing I would say, people get this idea that if social being determines social consciousness, then there is no possibility of transformation. Because it's this kind of like Western Marxist Frankfurt School super holism in which you've got this totality that's seamless and monolithic. I don't think capitalism is a seamless monolithic totality. I think it's a divided, contradictory totality. And it produces its own gravediggers and produces the thought of its own gravediggers. That's the basis for building. I mean, there are people who are oppressed, you know, unexploited, and unhappy, and they know it. And they know that there needs to be change, and that they want that. So there are people who are responsive to, you know, the right kind of overtures. I mean, the main problem in the country in which I live, the United States, is that the left is up to here with elitism. You know, every moment we hear, you know, we have to raise people's consciousness, we have to raise people's consciousness, we have to raise people's consciousness. You know, and I can tell you stories about, like, how, you know, regular people just get turned off by this. I mean, how would you feel if, you know, we're told that you have backward consciousness or false consciousness and your consciousness has to be raised and your... It's just... That's a big problem. Regarding the self-valorization of value in the USSR, the issue of indirectly social labor, it's very interesting. In 1943, there was an article actually written by Leontief, not Vasily Leontief, Alexei Leontief, the chief, Stalin's chief economic theorist. There was an unsigned article in the main theoretical journal, and in this article, they actually revised the economic teaching of the law of value. And they said that the law of value exists in the USSR. The USSR is a commodity-producing society, and so you have a socialist commodity-producing society in which the law of value prevails, and there's money, and all of this. And by the way, Raya got a copy of this article, which it was not in the West, this was in the midst of the war. She brought it to the attention of the New York Times. She got it published in the American Economic Review, and that touched off a big debate in which she participated. But in this article by Leontief in 1943, the argument was that despite the law of value, the commodities, the money, and all of that, labor was directly social because the product of labor did not have to be mediated by the market in order to become social. In other words, the workers would produce, and for their labor to count as labor, it did not have to be the case that the product was first sold in the market and able to command a price. That was the argument. I think that if you read the critique of the Gotha program, which I was talking about, with this issue of directly social labor in mind, you get a very different sense of what the issue is for Marx. Because he's saying, you know, you have like the John Gray kind of thing, where, you know, you work for a week, you put into the store, the bank, you withdraw a week's labor of other people. Marx is saying this is not the way it works in a commodity-producing society, because one person's week of labor is not equal to another person's week of labor. So there's a quantitative dimension in the way Marx is talking about directly social labor that is missing from the official 1943 Russian conception. Yes, you know, any labor that the plan said, here's what we want you to do, that counted immediately as labor, you know, irrespective of going through a market. But the labor was not equal. And they explicitly said that in that document as well, you know, because they said we have payment according to labor here, but quantity and quality of labor. And what they meant by quantity of labor was not the amount of time that people worked, but the quantity of products they produced. And then, of course, you had the quality of labor, which was a way of, you know, sanctioning the higher pay of managers and the technocrats and the bureaucracy and so forth.
Another question. This state capitalism Raya Dunayevskaya, describes in her books, and you also ascribe to this view, is it possible only under the conditions of international market capitalism? What I'm getting at is capital volume one. Exchange value is exists only as exchange value, which appears to exist as price. So basically, what if we have global state capitalism, or is it still capitalism, or is it only another class society where you have surplus labor, but you don't surplus product, but you don't have surplus value?
Well, we don't know because we haven't seen it, but you know, this is not just a matter of definition. I personally cannot conceive of how that would be capitalist. Competition at some level in some way is needed to enforce the law of value. Either, you know, competition in the market or global competition for world domination. Some kind of competition between capitals is needed, you know, to enforce that idea that the labor does not count if it's expended beyond what's socially necessary. You know, I could be wrong. I mean, it could be that, you know, there will be someday one single world capital. I can't imagine it for the reason I just told you, but I could be wrong. Dunayevskaya, by the way, didn't think it was possible. I mean, she basically said, I think what I just said.
Thank you very much. However interesting such arcane scholastic debates are, and however important it is to tease out the potential contradictions of the Soviet Union in the 20th century, I'm not entirely sure in what ways this kind of analysis and understanding helps us today to think about socialism slash communism in the 21st century. Isn't it the case that one of the great failures of socialism, whether it was Western or Eastern, and therefore also the Soviet Union, was the erroneous idea that the law of value would operate better under socialism than under capitalism? That, in other words, what many of the arguments in the late 19th century, in the 20th century, shared, despite their major theoretical disagreements, was that the expansion of value would be more successful and better than in the crisis-prone system that we call capitalism. Isn't therefore one of the key lessons we have to learn from the failure of 20th century really existing socialism that the abolition of the law of value is precisely what is at stake, including its consequences? Which means that the abolition of the law of value does mean that those who want to participate in the practices of constructing that cannot be capitalism. You cannot be capitalism on what it is so good at, that is the self-expansion of value. And I would argue in the 21st century, the abolition of the law of value, and through that abolishing competition, also is not only vital in terms of organizing self-determination, self-organization of people in their life and their production, but also in terms of the ecological predicament that we're in, the expansion of the law of value is not any longer quite literally sustainable. Capitalism is running to the end, also ecologically speaking. So is not the first requirement to think about socialism and communism in the 21st century to recognize that the abolition of the law of value does mean the end of the endless self-expansion of value that characterizes capitalism?
Yeah, I mean, first of all, I wasn't trying in this talk really to deal with why, you know, the USSR failed. I mean, this is not a talk, as I understood it, about the USSR or even the concept of state capitalism. The whole talk was driving towards the point at the end that transitional society is not coherent as a Marxian concept. So what I hope that people will take away is not that I said the USSR is state capitalist. You don't need me to say that. That's been said before. What I thought that I was doing that might be helpful today for our times is to say that there are various manifestations of what I call political determinism, various manifestations of the idea that political and legal changes, you know, will make a new society in and of themselves, or they together with changes in consciousness, where you don't go to the relations of production and say that those things have got to be changed, or you think that, you know, decision making and the right people with the right priorities and new forms of organization are going to change things. These are very widespread beliefs throughout the social movements. So I don't even think that, you know, this is like an exegesis of Marxian concepts for Marxists. I'm trying to talk to the entire movement here. I mean, in answer to your question about the law of value, I think we're in agreement, but you said that they said that the law of value would work better under socialism than under capitalism. Did they actually say it like that?
It's the development of the forces of production and the expansion of value, socially speaking. Yes, that was the dominant view held by socialist both on the West side.
Yeah. Oh, there was certainly a belief. Yeah. There was certainly a belief
that was superior in terms of developing the forces of production together.
Yeah. There was certainly that belief, and that was not specific.
Isn't that one of the key issues we need to tackle today? That any form of social organization, predicated upon self-organization, the solidaristic, egalitarian, ecologically sane way, will not be able to outcompete capitalism in terms of its capacity of expansion of value?
Right. It's not the case that everybody used the term value, but definitely, and this was by no means limited to, you know, the Stalinists. It was by no means limited to people who called themselves Marxists. Definitely, there was a strong preference for socialism's ability, supposed ability to produce more, to grow more rapidly. That was very widespread throughout socialist thinking in general. Yeah, I think we have to be critical of that. You know, I don't think that that's real hard to be critical of that. I think, you know, a lot of society now is very attuned to the problems of growth making. So I think that, you know, you're absolutely right, but I think that's an easy thing to get across.
Other questions, comments? Hmm?
I would like to come back to just for the more political direction. If I understand you correctly, you're saying what we need is a revolution. Nothing short of a revolution can change or bring us to the path to socialism, right? The first question is, how do we get to this? It's how do we get there? Campus situation of revolution, and I think that's a lot of thinking that goes on. And also, I would like to come back your argument. Also, you said it makes no sense to nationalize capital, for example, or do anything in capitalism to change capitalism. Preparing for a kind of socialism. The second thing is, in following that up, and also the other thing I would be curious to know, when you mentioned the average American and people critique that it's not a problem of conscience, right? What do you think of these people? They have to wait until we have a revolution? It's bad for you, or maybe you're going to experience it in your lifetime, or probably your children. And my second question then is also, what your view on what's going on in South America? Carlos talks about, or that used to talk about, the Bolivarian Revolution. you think this is a form of revolution that may lead us to socialism? And what's your take on that?
I'm going to pull a Michael Kliman. I have no more expertise about the kind of political questions, how do we get there, than you do, probably less. I don't think anybody knows. I am critical of the question, though. I think the question is reminiscent of transitional society thinking. So I'm not happy with the question. If the question is, what can we do short of the revolutionary transformation of society, there is a lot we can do. The fact that certain reforms are not steps on the road to socialism, and certainly are not themselves part socialism, that doesn't mean that they're not worth fighting for. They're worth fighting like hell for. You're not going to turn capitalism into socialism. But another thing I agree with Michael Perlman about is this system is weak. It's a lot weaker than I've ever seen it. And that matters a lot, because global finance depends on confidence and stability. And that is still really shaky right now. I mean, we're not at the place that we were in 2008 with a panic in the financial markets, but things are not good in terms of the consciousness of the investors in, you know, confidence in the future. And this, what matters to capitalists more than, especially finance, financial capitalists more than anything, is global stability. And we have a really unstable situation right now in many ways, and have particularly since 9/11. So concessions can be wrung from them. In the midst of the Great Depression, when you got millions of people in the United States, you know, tens of millions of people out of work, things were really bad. You know, and if you want to talk about austerity, that was austerity. And in the midst of that, working people were able to win real concessions that improved their lives. Did the capitalist class come back and fight to take away those things? Damn straight. Have they succeeded in doing so? You know, to some extent. So there's an ongoing class battle. But yeah, concessions are really important. They're totally important right now. You know, when you've got tens of millions of people out of work, you have people losing their homes, you have people losing their incomes, we have to, it's just a matter of elemental human solidarity to side with them and to support them in their struggles, and in any which way we can. And one, you know, beyond whatever to fight the immediate struggle, one thing to do is to say, you know, you don't like the society, but we don't like it either, and let's together work out ways to move beyond it, right? Rather than, like, here, you know, follow me. But yeah, I mean, in the United States, I think it was at the end of 2008, or maybe early 2009, there was a poll conducted by Rasmussen, Scott Rasmussen, a Republican pollster, and it was, what do you prefer, capitalism or socialism? And among low-income people, there was only a very slight preference for capitalism over socialism. And among young people as well, under 30, only a very slight preference for capitalism over socialism, right? And this is despite the USSR and everything like that. And the left did not respond to that challenge. What you had in the United States in the left were people saying, oh, there really is no crisis here. I swear to God, they were saying there was no real crisis here. Because in their view, if you admit that capitalism was in crisis, and the system is not working, then of course that means that you have to support the bailout of the banks and everything like that. So we have to say that things are actually good in the system, and there's all this wealth to spread around, and we just need to spread it around. And that's the main line of thinking on the American, North American left, including, you know, Canada, as we talked about Naomi Klein, who's the major voice of the radical left, I guess, throughout North America. So, I definitely support concessions. They're really important. They can be won. The one thing I want to say, though, is concessions are concessions. They are not going to put capitalism on a new growth path. They are not solutions to the crisis. They are not steps on the road to socialism. They're just plain concessions. So it's one thing, for instance, to say, you know, people need to keep their homes, people need to keep their jobs or their incomes or both. Okay, and it's another thing to say, you know, let's have a wage-led growth economy, and let's, you know, transform capitalism, you know, through stimulus and this and that. I mean, the austerity policies are not working, but the stimulus policies that we have in a big way in the United States, they're not really working as well. They're also not really working. The U.S. government has run up over $7 trillion in debt since the recession began at the end of 07. You know, besides the official stabilization measures, the official stimulus measures, there's what's called automatic stabilizers. You know, incomes are down, and they don't bring in as much tax money, and they don't try to like balance the budget by raising taxes. So they borrow more. And you look at that's also stimulative policy. That's not pulling the U.S. out of this. So, you know, I can't figure out how to bring them out of the crisis. You got really smart people who really believe in the system and working at it full time, and they can't figure it out, so I'm not going to figure it out. And I think the idea of the left trying to solve this crisis, or the left trying to make capitalism better, or something, we should forsake that and get down to the root of it, which is, let's improve people's actual conditions on the ground. Okay, so we can definitely do those kinds of things. So I'm not talking about abstract revolution here, you know, revolution or nothing. There's a lot of things that can be done. The question is, none of the concessions are going to be lasting. There's going to be a continual struggle until we get rid of this system. And, you know, you have a state-run bank. Well, you know, is that a step towards socialism? Or is that a step towards what you have in Slovenia, which is evidently a state-run banking crisis?
End the discussion here, because we're running out of time. So I would thank Andrew Kliman again for his talk, and I would just inform you before you all leave that tomorrow we have two panel discussions at 11 a.m. and 1 p.m. respectively. The first one will be on the topic of the commons, the second one on the topic of primitive accumulation in the post-socialist transition, and then at 6 p.m. a keynote lecture by Werner Bonnefeld. Thank you.